self-hosting cloud storage on Raspberry Pi is perfect for anyone who doesn't want to pay regular fees for external storage space, and anyone who wants to have full control over their personal cloud files. I will show you how to quickly and easily get the open source software Nextcloud running on Raspberry Pi using Docker, and afterwards show you some of the main features. This time I will skip the Raspberry Pi setup and Docker installation because I already explained it in my Bitwarden video from a few weeks ago. Click the interactive card in the top right corner or use the link in the description to watch that video. So, Docker is installed, we are connected to the Pi, now it's time to download the Nextcloud Docker image. I will include the most important commands for copy-pasting in the video description. The official image is simply called Nextcloud, which should download the correct image for your device automatically. But depending on the instruction set of the device you are using, you might want to use a specific image. Many Raspberry Pi models only support 32-bit software and a specific ARM version. For example, ARM 32v7 should be fine. You can look up which instruction set is supported on the Wikipedia page and view all available image architectures on the Nextcloud Docker Hub. Type docker pull nextcloud or the respective instruction set you are using before that and /nextcloud. This image includes an Apache web server running on the port 80. To start Nextcloud immediately, type docker run --name nextcloud -d -p 8080:80 and the image name. This would mean Nextcloud is available on port 8080, but you can change it to another if you'd like. The Nextcloud setup screen should show up after a few minutes at the IP address of the Pi and our specified port. By default, Nextcloud uses an SQLite database, which is not recommended for permanent use, so we will instead quickly create a dedicated database container for our Nextcloud installation. This also gives us the option to fine-tune the settings of our container. Stop and remove the Nextcloud container. Then I will download the database software called PostgreSQL. Docker pull PostgreS. In Docker, containers are by default isolated from each other. In order to make the Nextcloud container see the database container, they need to be on the same Docker network. Let's create a Docker network and name it Nextcloud-net. Docker network create --driver bridge nextcloud-net. The run command from before now needs to specify the network using --network. Run the database container using docker run --name postgres-e postgres password. Type in a database user password, specify the network nextcloud-net and append -d postgres. Now the database container should start in the background and automatically create the default user postgres along with a default database of the same name. If you want to optionally mount the database folder to see what's inside, include -v, specify a directory in your host file system and append the container directory var lib postgresql data. This container always needs to be running simultaneously to the Nextcloud container. Next, we will start the Nextcloud container again with a few more settings. Paste the command from the description and make any desired changes. When both containers are running, switch again to the setup page of Nextcloud. Assign a Nextcloud username and password, then switch the database type to PostgreSQL and type in the credentials username postgres, the password from the run command, the default database named postgres, and the container we also named postgres. Decide whether to install some default apps and then wait a few minutes for Nextcloud to finish the installation. This installation is now reachable on your local network, but not on the internet. I would recommend to leave it that way for security reasons, and in case you need to, you could access your network from the outside using a personal VPN, for example, hosted by your router. If you want to expose your server to the internet, you will need a domain name, a reverse proxy, and a security certificate, for example from Let's Encrypt. I've included a link to a step-by-step guide on how to set this up. For now, let's look at some of the features in Nextcloud. For one, there's your typical cloud storage. You organize files in folders, copy and paste them, create documents and download them. There is a dedicated Photos tab to get previews of your photo library and videos. Activity shows recent activity on your Nextcloud instance, for example, when a folder was created or a calendar event was edited. Talk is for chats and web meetings, so more of an enterprise feature. Mail can integrate an existing email account and acts as a web-based email client. As I understand it, this is not a self-hosted email server, but just the client, like Mozilla Thunderbird, for example. Contacts is of course an address book that can be synced using WebDAV. The same goes for the calendar. You can either use the web calendar or sync this data to other desktop or mobile calendars. In the lower left, you can copy the links to enter in your other clients and devices. These are just the default apps. Nextcloud can quickly add more using the Nextcloud Web Store. This adds support for previewing more file types, file sharing, better security features and search, or new administrative tools. The Nextcloud settings are largely self-explanatory and include useful tips. You can check the security of your installation, impose restrictions on the features available to users, or view statistics. Theming is also available to quickly change colors and logos. Browse through the topics at least once for a good overview. To add users, switch to the users page and click New User. Then type in a username and password and optionally select a group. To use an external hard drive with Nextcloud, connect it to the USB ports of the Raspberry Pi and switch back to an SSH session. I have to admit, combining Windows file systems and Linux is usually a nightmare, so if you want to make your life significantly easier, format the external drive to the file system ext4 first. Find out the partition ID by typing lsblk. In this case, it's SDA1. Then optionally, format it using sudo mkfs.ext4 def sda1. Next, create a mount point for the drive, for example, media USB drive, and mount the drive with sudo mount def sda1 media USB drive. Finally, we have to make sure the default user for web servers, www.data, has access to this mounted folder, so use this chown command. Now all we have to do is tell the Nextcloud container about this folder. Stop and remove the Nextcloud container and add to its run command -v media USB drive :data, which mounts the drive to the container folder data. The drive is ready to be enabled in the Nextcloud web interface. Allow support for external storage by enabling external storage support in the disabled apps. Then, in the administration section of the settings, not the personal section, click on external storages and add a new local storage. Name it and provide the directory path. We chose /data. All users should now be able to see and write to this external storage. I think this covers the basics for a Nextcloud installation. There is much more you can do with Nextcloud. There are dedicated apps for many devices, and it is constantly being improved. If you have any questions, try to get them solved in the comments, and I will see you in the next video.